to Awake Ones. I'm Alexandra Wenman.
I'm Lorraine Flaherty.
And I'm Sally Poinsett-Nash.
And today we're going to be talking about what is your favourite spiritual practice. So, Sally, let's start with you, my darling.
One of my favourite spiritual practices is being out in nature. It always has been. I grew up in the countryside, and just being in nature for me is a time where I can ground myself, and I just feel like I'm at home when I'm in nature, filmed with a city backdrop.
And on the first sunny day I think we've had so far this year.
So nature first, salt baths are a second favourite.
That was mine, you stole it!
I didn't steal it. We're not doing it together.
Oh my god, don't visualise that.
No. So yeah, salt baths, you know, I have a dog at home, and it just is a time to shut the door and just have some me time, and a salt bath is always a good idea, especially living in a city.
It's needed, isn't it?
It is, yeah. And we've also asked our Instagram followers and Facebook followers what their favourite spiritual practice is, so we'll be coming to those. But Lorraine, what's yours?
Well, I think, obviously, hypnosis is my thing, so doing self-hypnosis has got to be my number one, really, where I'm able to go in and connect and travel through the ethers. But funny enough, on a really very grounded, earthly level, I think for me it's driving. So when I get in the car,
she just goes into hypnosis.
I do drive carefully, people. Part of me is driving and paying absolute attention, but I tend to have lots of really, really kind of great inspirations and really incredible moments, downloads and channeling, and all sorts of stuff happens when I'm in the car, particularly long journeys. And I do drive a lot, and I do quite often do, you know, 4 or 5 hour stints in the car. There have been known road trips for me to drive for 10 hours in a day. And so at that point, I'm so in tune with nature and what's going on around me, but I just get into a real zone, and I don't ever put radios on. I'm not listening to anything, so it is literally just whatever is going on in my head and whatever is actually coming through. So
I'm just laughing because as I used to race cars, so there's loud music, there's big engines, there's fast cars, and then there's Lorraine. And we had to follow Lorraine on our recent road trip to California, which for me was like, you'd get out of the car and you'd have channeled messages and whatever, and I'd just be like, I need to go for a drive and get my driving out of my system.
The thing is, you know, I actually, ordinarily, I do love to drive fast and really go for it, but the thing in America is that I'm not going to take any chances in a hire car actually getting caught, and I've had a few instances where I have been pulled over by the police over there, so it has made me a little bit more wary, so I do tend to do things properly now when I'm driving on the highway. But yeah, but for the salt baths as well, so at my home, that's a great way to go out and just take a handle. How about you?
Salt baths. Definitely number one. I think we're all in agreement on that one.
Your salt baths are something else though.
Yeah,
this one does epic salt baths. I mean, I do salt baths. I might be in there for 20 minutes, half an hour. It can be, what would you say was the longest salt bath you've done?
I've been known to be in there 2 or 3 hours.
Two or three hours, yeah.
I think it's, I was kind of, it all fits together with all my favourite spiritual practices. I tend to sort of do it all in the salt bath because like channeling is probably my number one favourite, since I realised that I could do it and kind of learnt how to do it. I just love tuning in and kind of combining, how do I even put it? It's like a combination of a guided meditation or a guided journey with channeled messages, with visualisation, with kind of flying into the realms whilst being very grounded and present and aware of what's going on. So it's like a salt bath is, I guess, the perfect place to do it, because it's a little bit like a sensory deprivation chamber. You're really sealed off from the rest of the world, from the phone, from anything. Sometimes I take the phone in there to record messages, but it's a great place to cocoon yourself from anything, and then it's so grounding and so kind of, it's a little bit like being in amniotic fluid, isn't it? Like in a womb, and you feel really safe and you can create a really sacred space in your bathroom in order to sort of open up and explore everything. Safely held. So I think, that the salt bath as the container, and then channeling, guided meditation. I do a bit of chanting, bit of singing, bit of everything, and then I come out. My husband's like, "What on earth? What is going on?" It's like just hours. It's like, "Are we gonna watch a show or anything tonight?" No, I'm off to bed. Bye. So yeah,
I tend to put in as much salt as however bad I'm feeling.
Yes, me too. It's like you. One handful, no, the whole bag.
Yeah, so sometimes I'm surprised I'm not just laying on top of my bath.
It's like the Dead Sea at home.
4 kilos.
That's why I don't buy those big in bulk bags, because the whole thing would go in.
Ends up going in.
So what kind of salt do you usually use?
I'm at the moment I'm using a Himalayan salt with, it's been infused with rosemary, which my husband brought home. 4 kilos of it because he found it on offer somewhere, but sometimes I use Epsom salts. It's whatever I can get my hands on, really. I do like it when it's infused with something, just because it gives you the, you can't use your shampoo and everything whilst you're having the salt bath, use it at the end. So yeah, it just gives that nice smell at the same time.
I've got the eucalyptus and Dead Sea salts at the moment. It's a very Australiana.
It's quite pungent.
It's a combination of the sacred desert lands and the Australian desert land combined. Yeah, I like it. It's a bit of touch of home. Yeah.
That'll be right.
It's nice. It's different. It's unusual. Yeah.
Although, do you remember we bought some Ibiza salt with us as well?
Yeah.
So that's a whole different experience when you bathe in the
We should be professional salt samplers.
I think.
Anyone wants us to promote their salt bar?
Have you been to those sort of isolated desensitization chambers?
Yeah,
There's one nearby here.
Yeah. So
the flotation
tanks.
Yeah, I
did one years and years ago as a child. My mum used to go and do them, so I went with her once and did it then. But I haven't done it as an adult. And there is one fairly close by. We should go. A wig once in a salt bath.
Not all together. Yeah, isn't it?
Separate salt bath.
Yeah, swimwear. Float around.
Yeah, I mean they're quite amazing, except that I made a real kind of schoolgirl error one of the first times I went in there, because I had a cut on my ankle, and you're in this chamber that is literally just saline solution that's body temperature, so you're floating, and it is meant to be womb-like, and it is meant to be very calm and tranquil, but when salt actually gets into the cut and a wound, and you have nothing else to think about, obviously in that state, it amplifies everything that you're feeling. So I was in excruciating pain for the entire hour that I was there, and all I could think about was the pain in my ankle, and I was trying to float out of my body and go somewhere else, and that worked a little bit, but my awareness kept coming back to this.
Do you know, I didn't like it either.
Oh, didn't you?
Is that interesting?
Oh, I liked it.
I kind of did. I have done those twice.
Yeah.
The second time I did it, I liked it because I actually used the neck pillow.
Right.
But the first time I did it, I wanted to do it properly, and you're supposed to absolutely just let go and let everything unwind, and not like, just because the salt is supposed to hold you and you're naturally buoyant.
Yeah.
But I found that my neck pain that I was trying to alleviate, this was back in the day I was working as a journalist, it got worse and worse and worse, because it was almost like as it was unwinding, and I just couldn't quite, maybe now it would be a different story because I now know how to really unwind and relax, but I couldn't just let go and let it was like all my tension just sort of became really heightened here. And when I look back at the time, you know, I was doing work where I was trying to hold up the universe, so I was probably, I'm not letting go. It's really painful.
It will amplify everything that's going on, but I did it another time and made sure that my body was all okay, and it was quite amazing because you really lost all concept of where you were. So there were times when I felt like I was spinning that way, and then there were times when I felt it was almost like being on a roller coaster. I was spinning, it was almost like being in space. So amazing.
Zero gravity chamber.
It was like a zero gravity chamber, even though I kind of knew I wasn't moving, but in my awareness I was. But I've also had that experience at a gong bath.
Yes.
So the gong bath when...
But you did it kind of a bit like Al does a salt bath to epic proportions.
Yes.
I think you did a gong bath to epic proportions.
I did an overnight
24 hour gong bath.
Yeah, that was very interesting, because when you're in a room with about 50 other people all on mattresses, and and just, you know, being taken on this journey, and then having somewhere in the scheme of that to actually let go and go to sleep was quite strange. It was amazing. It's just that there were a few times when the gongs swapped over that, and I'm not sure if they were aware of it, but obviously sound has a frequency, and the sound is what actually carries you through space. So any shamans that are doing rituals and ceremonies, you know, they keep the music, they keep the tone, because it's keeping your energy up. It's a little bit like a bird flying on a, you know, when they catch the air, the sound of the air. And so they would sometimes stop when they were swapping over. Instead of one coming in and actually gently
doing
a bit of a remix and, you know, mixing the two things together, while they were swapping over, they would just stop. And so I would be on this really lovely journey where I was floating off somewhere and travelling, and it was just like, bang! Oh, what just happened? I came completely back. And so there were a few moments in it where it was a little bit frustrating, because I then had to wait for them to start all over again and then start the journey travelling again. So I think at a certain point I might have just switched off and gone to sleep. But it was amazing, and I highly recommend gong baths. Yeah. The only thing with the gong bath is that, and this one that I went to, they were very good actually. They did tell people to have a bit of an intention or a bit of an idea, because if you don't, and I have been to people that haven't said it, if you don't set an intention, then you are very likely to be carried to a random place that you might not have been expecting. Such as, do you remember on my birthday a few years ago? We had a day of dancing for the day. We'd been to a 60s go-go dancing lesson, and then we went off and we were doing a five rhythms-y type thing, and it was all great and wonderful. And then at the end, there was a gong bath. And so I was just on a complete dancing high. I'd had a really lovely time. It was, it was all very holistic, and, you know, no alcohol or anything else. So we were very...
I think we did cacao, didn't we?
We had some cacao. Yeah. Anyway, so I lay down for the gong bar thinking, yay, this is a day off and this is my birthday and I'm going to have a really nice time and I'm just going to let go and enjoy it. And then immediately got hurled into a past life where I think I was a serial murderer.
Relaxing.
It was really relaxing. I was hacking people up and chopping them up, and then I had to
go
through
the hole. We were in deepest, darkest Hackney for this.
We
so
were.
So you're probably tuning into bloody Jack the Ripper or something.
It was almost it was a bit Jack the Ripper. I think I'd ended up being a prostitute or something, because I'd been abused. I think it was by a priest actually in my early years, and so I kind of got a bit feral and anti-men, and so in the throes of passion would then, you know, pack them up, which was really charming. And so I had to spend the whole of the session then calling all of these souls in that I'd murdered and going, I'm so sorry, I'm really sorry that I killed you.
Happy birthday, Lorraine.
Yeah, happy birthday to me. And so setting intention on your spiritual journeys is a really good idea, because otherwise you will end up in places that you're not expecting to go.
Yeah, that's a great piece of advice. I'm not bored of you and checking my phone. I'm just going to go on my phone. I'm going to just have a quick look at who has said what.
Yes.
And then what you think of it. So, the lovely Jan Ritchie,
yes,
who has supported us from day one. Thank you, Jan. Her favourite spiritual practices, there are 8 of them. And we start off with channeled ascended masters.
Yeah.
And mantras, and then Joshua David Stone's burning pot, Epsom salts, pour in some rubbing alcohol, drop a match in, the flame burns up all the negativity on etheric, astral and mental plane.
Oh, I'm going to give that a whirl. Amazing.
Sounds like a good one. The bath?
Yeah. Flambe bath time.
grounding exercises, protection exercises, columns of light, yes, and chakra work. Activations, and then angels, archangels, ascended masters, star beings, and much, much, much more.
Oh, yes. I think we can relate to all of the above. I think we've probably all kind of touched on somewhere along the line versions of all of those things.
Haven't done the burning pot.
No,
we haven't done the burning pot. I mean, we've done burning ceremonies. We have done shamanic burning and releasing ceremonies. So that's often a part of work that we do, particularly at retreats where people spend time going through and working out what they're ready to let go of, and then either creating symbols for it or just writing the words out, and then at the end
I'm a big fan of burning stuff in the cauldron.
Exactly. Ritual, ceremony, give it back to the fire, and you know, let the fire spirits take it away. So again, that's going to
I wrote letters a while ago to a bunch of people that I'd done work with in the past that, you know, just bad energy was still hanging around, and I felt I needed to say stuff but not actually.
Yeah.
So I wrote the letters, and sort of the messiest relationship of all of those, I wrote them in different colour Sharpies based on that person's colour.
Yeah.
And two of them burnt up beautifully, and the one that had kind of left the biggest residue with me energetically was written in a purple Sharpie, and it turned my entire fire grate purple when it burned up. And yeah, there's still some purple on my grate in my fire, which I didn't think was actually possible.
Yeah.
But just shows what a mess that person left behind.
Because I remember doing a ceremony like that a few years ago, and I'd actually written letters. So again, that is a really good idea, because you can vent and you can say all the things that you wish that you could have said but weren't able to, and just throw it on the paper. It's getting it out of you. And I've written letters in the same pen to people, and when I burnt them, the flames were different colours, and that was really weird.
Yeah, it's really telling, isn't it?
Yeah. And some of them were smaller, and some of the flames were definitely bigger. You think, aha, yeah, I know where that is.
Yeah, right.
I bless you with love.
Michelle has said meditation by focusing only on my breath. It's so much easier for me with my loud brain. Smudging, learning to communicate with my pendulum, dabbling with alchemy, and salt baths on days that I'm home.
Yes.
So I think salt baths tend to run as a theme through this.
Yeah, sure. And I have a point on that one, because this is something that comes up a lot with guiding people into meditation and hypnosis. Is the, you know, the loud brain, I call it chattery monkey mind. And I've always found that whatever process you do, if you find something for chattery monkey mind to do, if you give chattery monkey mind a task, or even create a space in your mind's eye that you can allow that part of you to go to, there's usually way less resistance. And if you invite that part to participate in the journey, even if it's just to be the observer and the kind of narrator of what's actually going on, because I think a lot of meditation techniques are requiring you to drop into silence and to banish that part. You know, we're constantly fighting or battling that part of the mind to get it to go away, and that is just going to cause trouble. That's just
some sort of bug.
Do I have a
some sort of bug?
I have a.
Is it
a
lady?
It's left the building.
I'm just attracting
she's
nature.
She's looking at you like. Speaking of which, I like communing with insects.
Yes.
That's a good spiritual practice. Like talking to insects and nature.
And trees, obviously.
Incense.
I talk to incense too. Please burn nicely. My house smell nice. No, yeah, when I was really little, I remember having telepathic conversations with like cicadas and crickets and things like that. And they're very musical. Tune in and sort of, just sort of listen to the space between the sounds. You'll get it's a vibration, it's an energy, it's a feeling, because we do so much with our brain, that it's nice to drop down into our feeling awareness and just feel, and then sometimes you can actually translate that into communication. It's quite a neat way of doing it.
I think the sound of the cicadas, though, is like, there's nothing quite like it.
Yeah,
absolutely. But have you heard the recording where they slowed the sounds down? The cricket song, which is just mind blowing, absolutely mind blowing. And then maybe we'll play a little sample of it in the video at some point. But somebody took the sound of the crickets and then worked out the ratio of what a cricket's lifespan was versus a human being's lifespan, and then slowed it down so that it would be the equivalent of what they were actually hearing, not what we were hearing as humans. And it was the most angelic,
so beautiful,
harmonised. It was like the most beautiful choir that you've ever heard. The first time I heard it made me cry.
Yeah, it's so stunning. Well, it's like, don't they say it's the difference in time, isn't it? They sort of do exist on a different dimensional level.
Course,
so if they live for a day, it's like they've lived an entire lifetime, and it doesn't feel like a day to them. It's time is all relative. So dimensionality.
Going back to my list.
Yes.
Crystal loves silence. Teresa, meditation and prayer. Sherry, cleansing my chakras, smudging my living space and meditation.
Yeah.
Sandra's backing that up with loving meditation, shamanic journeying, angelic Reiki healing, yoga and Tai Chi.
All of those, yep. all of the above, lovely.
So you were the first time I encountered the angelic Reiki healing.
It's lovely, really lovely. Yeah, I used to teach it. I don't teach it so much anymore. I still use it with clients, but I sort of handed it over to a load of my master teachers once I had my precious wisdom was being developed. So yeah, that's my favourite spiritual practice actually. One of my favourites is doing my precious wisdom. Any kind of energy healing that resonates with you, if you can get yourself attuned or even just don't necessarily need an attunement as such, you can just tune into your heart and ask your higher self to bring light and energy down through your hands and place it on different parts of the body. I work with Archangel Raphael a lot, and I've actually seen, I think it was even before I was attuned to any healing, I hurt my knee many years ago, and I was going to see an osteopath, and I asked Archangel Raphael to come in and heal it. It's a bit like when you said you turned blue with Brigon.
Right.
Literally, I turned green, and I was lying in the osteopathy room, just watching my whole body lit up in green light and my knees glowing with these green halos. It was really amazing, and it was such like evidence of just your intention, just setting that intention really works. So
yeah, Tai Chi I love. I spent a lot of time in Southeast Asia, and when you know, doing Tai Chi at home is one thing, but when you're doing it in an open park with a load of people that have been doing it for years, the energy is incredible.
Yeah,
it's amazing. But being Southeast Asia and being so tall, everyone was kind of like,
oh, the giants here.
I'm the Westerner that's not doing very well in the middle.
Yeah, and the other one that I quite like is Qigong, which,
yes.
You know, the two things, that they're very similar. But and I remember doing Qigong on a beach in Egypt, actually, by the Red Sea. And, yeah, the combination when you're working with energy in a really high energy place right next to the ocean, the desert behind us. I just remember thinking, wow, this energy was literally, when you do all the, you
feel it.
You could literally feel it moving around, and you know, these things that you're doing that looks like just random shapes, you could actually feel that energy moving. It was just incredible.
Just doing a wake box does.
Yeah.
Let's see if we can find someone to do that.
Coming up to a new moon as we film this, and it's a really great time for manifesting. And one of my favourite things to do is a vision board. And just like every time I've done a vision board, it has all happened. And the most amazing time I did it was way, way back before I even knew what I was doing. I think I did a workshop in it. We've got a workshop coming up, by the way, vision boarding, if anyone wants to join us. But I created this vision board. It was all about meeting the love of my life and meeting my husband. And I had pictures on there of like everything on this vision board I've done, pretty much. Machu Picchu, hot air ballooning in Egypt, pyramids, like everything. And, you know, and it all came absolutely true. And then I, alongside that, like to write sort of, like you guys said, letters to the universe of, please universe. Or thank you universe. Because always do it in the present tense, in the positive, because I asked for a non-smoker and got a man that smoked like a chimney, he's now gradually pulling out of that. But yeah, hilarious, like do it in the present tense and in the positive. Don't ask for what you don't want, ask for what you do want. But
right.
Yeah, and then burning it and releasing it, candle magic and all sorts of
full moon rituals out, or your new moon rituals. So we've got Brad, who says prayer smudging merrily, the different frequency sound music. She's saying the 432 hertz.
And there are some very particular pieces by Mozart as well that are really excellent for helping you to get into the zone, and particularly if you're needing to study or you're wanting to be able to really focus. I can't remember exactly, I'll find out exactly what the pieces are, but some of them are really, really helpful. And I think there are some others as well that are really, really helpful for pregnant or expecting mothers to play while babies in the womb, because they are very calming, and they can then be used subsequently when wanting to calm a baby after they've been born, because they will hear the sounds and remember the sounds that they picked up in the womb. So always a good idea to play soothing music to them as well.
There's a John Levine, a pianist, who's a friend of ours, who's a channel who channels beautiful angel music, works on these hertz. And there's also is it Ali Calderwell? Did some work with Glenn Harrell. Glenn Harrell is a really great hypnotherapist as well, yeah. And he worked with Ali Caldwell and worked with the music to work with the guided meditation as well as the music. It's really good stuff. I'd quite like to get Glenn on the show.
Some music.
Hey Glenn, if you're watching,
bring the tunes.
Yes, we both went to the same hypnotherapy college. So,
did you? I was wondering if you knew him.
Yeah, it was funny. I remember the first time I listened to one of his recordings, I would be showing my age because it was a cassette.
This wasn't an age.
that would be pushing it. Although I do remember those, my dad had them, so yeah, guilty. But I was kind of listening to the track and I was thinking, oh, this is really familiar, because it was almost exactly what I said, because it was what I had been taught at the college. And I remember researching, did he go to my same college? Because it was just the same use of language and the same kind of tonality. So yeah.
I like Merrilee's list. It's a long one.
Okay.
But, alongside the different frequencies. She's got diffuser with essential oils.
Oh yeah, go doTERRA.
Breathing with the 4-7-8 method.
Yeah. So you breathe in for the count of 4, hold it for 7, release it for 8.
It's like a pranayama, isn't
yeah.
it?
Oh, yeah.
We did something similar with
Gemma.
Gemma.
Yes, and you can do the where yes. you hold the nose as well and do that. But any of those ones where you do the, there's a few different variations. Which again, it's kind of yogic breathing, so that's very helpful.
My pronunciation may be off here, but I know you know what this is, the Ho-po-pono-pono.
Well, it's actually Ho-o-pono-pono.
Ho-o-pono-pono.
Yeah, that one.
You do the Ho-po-pono and you turn.
4 phases.
Yes, so that's the Hawaiian Huna prayer. I'm sorry, please forgive me, I love you, thank you. Very, very powerful, and it's a prayer that you, whatever's going on in your world, if you're not liking something, then you identify what it is and then find that in you, and then you do the prayer on you, not on the external. And as you, the Hawaiian Hunas believed that as you healed you and changed it in you, that the outside world would change.
And it
we've
worked.
All had experience of that. It's really powerful.
You know I don't know them off by heart, but you know the 4 agreements as well, don't you?
Oh, ish, just about. I'm not sure.
Be impeccable with your word. Something. Yeah. We should look this up.
So we will find
we'll
those
find
ones.
Out.
Yes, those are also very good.
Look up the 4 agreements.
Yes.
Merrilee goes on to say bells and singing bowls.
Yes, that will always clear the energy.
Biomat crystal bed.
Yes. Oh yes, we tried some of those. So. Have you tried those?
No.
Okay, so the biomat is usually filled with crystals. So the one I went on was filled with amethyst. Where literally it's just like a bit like rubber, aren't they?
Something like that.
Whatever,
they've got
silicon or something. They've got sacred geometry patterns, and they are literally full of crystals. And then you lie on them, and then some of the practitioners will actually have a light grid that goes over you that has the colours of the chakras over your chakra points. And so that then amplifies, it's a bit like the John of God crystal bed as well. We can get the separate ones. But you can buy those mats. You can actually buy them and have them at home. You can actually put them in your own bed. I wouldn't recommend that you leave them in there for long periods of time, because
you might fry your nervous system.
They are really powerful. So if you were going to get one, just do it a little bit at a time. But yeah, they are amazing.
Yeah, I had magnets, like loads of magnets in my bed. I had to take them out because it was just too much.
Yeah, too bad.
It was all right initially, but then it started to really affect me.
It's like sitting under a pyramid too. You can you can even make your own. You can create like a copper or pyramid to hang from the ceiling. And that shape, it sort of harnesses higher vibration energy and then brings it down and anchors it here, which is why it's...
You must have seen the guy walking around London with the pyramid on his head.
No.
Huh? I've been seeing this guy since,
thank you.
I think I've been, bless you, seeing him since about the late 90s.
Oh, really?
Yeah, there's a guy who walks around London.
What, like a wild?
He's
like
got a metal pyramid on his head at all times.
Nice hat, great idea.
Yeah.
Does he have a cover over it when it's raining?
He doesn't.
Because I think that would be ideal. I hate umbrellas, so that would actually be the perfect thing, just a little pyramid.
I might get
and then
an obelisk
it would just bounce
hat.
The water off.
Merrilee's also saying grounding, feet on earth, sands, ocean waves, love,
bare feet in the ground.
Full moon bathing.
Oh yeah.
The Lomi Lomi massage.
Oh yes.
Yeah.
I had a Lomi Lomi. I had my first Lomi Lomi massage when we were in Desert Hot Springs, and I highly recommend it. Apparently, so does the so.
Someone order a Lomi Lomi.
Yes, but I highly recommend it. Again, we come back to the Hawaiians, we've got a bit of a theme going on here.
Yes, maybe we need to do awake ones in Hawaii.
Definitely.
Next,
it's Hawaiian massage. And I have to say that for the whole thing, I felt like I was being massaged with love. I just felt like love was just being poured into my cells and into my body. It was just absolutely amazing.
And communication with ancestors, spiritual guides, angels, light beings. Then we're moving on to Janice, who just likes breathing, which, you know, I think is very, it's quite an understated
way to underestimate just the power
breathing.
Well, we do it so consciously, yeah.
Yeah.
Breathing with intention.
Deep breathing, you know, a lot of the time you're just doing this shallow breath.
Yeah.
Stay very conscious to breathe properly.
And I think so many people do, you know, so many people are, you know, they're in a hurry and they don't take time to actually really breathe and let the oxygen. Oxygen is so important, we can't survive without it. So if you are tense, if you are stressed, you probably are likely to be shallow breathing, and it's probably the one time when you really, really do need to breathe properly. So yeah, never underestimate the power of just stopping and just really, really taking in deep breaths. I'm teaching medical students at the moment, and one of the exercises that I teach them is a really simple one, particularly for those that are stressed, and they're nearly always stressed, they've always got exams, or they've got this, or they've got this coming up. And so it's a really simple one where you get them to think about a feeling or a thought that is bothering you. And in their mind's eye, they think about that negativity, whatever it might be, as a particular colour. And then they think about something they might like instead, or positive thought or feeling, think of that as another colour. And then the simple exercise is they just imagine breathing out the negativity and breathing in the good colour. And the mind loves metaphors, it loves symbols, it loves to do things that make sense. So breathe out the bad, bring in the good, and the mind just goes, oh, okay. You know, our logical mind doesn't get it, but the unconscious part of the mind totally does. And it's brilliant, because when they've done that exercise, afterwards, they're all amazing. So I highly recommend you try that one as well.
Breathe, just breathe in love too, can't you?
Yeah.
Breathe love from above and below,
absolutely.
Light, and breathe it, and breathe out love, or like you said, breathe out the negativity to transform it into love.
Yeah.
But I just do breathe in love, breathe out love. And it builds, like, the more you do it as well. Yeah.
And that's lovely as well, because I think you do a meditation where you start sending the love out further and further and further, don't you, each time you're breathing in, which the more love you can send out to the planet, the better.
With your Australian accent there, breathe in love. Breathe out love.
Breathe in love, breathe out love. I love it. Can we get a t-shirt made in that?
You can.
Breathe in love.
Tanya loves yoga.
Yoga's
Chloe
always good.
Love. Joanna meditation. And Alison, I'd like to say thank you to Alison, because Alison said she likes the, is it Palo Santo or Palo Santo?
I say Palo, but
Palo.
Palo. G'day.
With a
Palo.
London accent, I'm not sure where to put it. But lighting Palo Santo, and
yeah.
I was just, what is this? I'd never heard of it. Was a bit of a white sage girl, and I was in Glastonbury a few weeks ago and managed to get my hands on the Palo Santo. And in, is it Star Child down there?
Yeah.
Amazing. You could smell that shop way before I saw it. And I'm now mildly addicted to the Palo Santo. And I'd actually sent a message back to Alison saying, thank you so much for introducing me to this. It's amazing.
Yes, we have been Palo Santo'd before we actually began the show today.
Everybody got Palo Santo. We're going to do it on the tube
yesterday.
On the way.
It's like a Palo Santo thing going on.
Yeah, it's amazing. Applying the patchouli oil, laying crystals on her mat and doing yoga. So thank you, Alison. Abundance Babe came up with forest bathing. Forest bathing. I love moon
bathing,
sun bathing.
Yeah.
Forest bathing.
Absolutely.
nothing like a long hike to soothe the soul.
Yes, so good. Yesterday, definitely. I was telling these guys I went on a walk, went to visit my friend Francesca, and she lives on a farm. And she was like, let's go for a walk. We're going to go for a little walk in the fields. Well, it turned into a walk in the mud. And I hadn't worn my wellies. I did have my shoes that walked us up Machu Picchu on, the waterproof walking shoes. But I literally came back with mud shoes, because the layer of mud around my feet was like Smurf feet with mud. But it was so good, and I was like a pig in poo, because we kept having to change direction, trying to find a way to walk with less mud. And the more we were like zigzagging across this field, we were just laughing our heads off. And it was, and she likes to be organized. She was like, this was not the walk I had in mind. And I was like going, honey, just go with it. It doesn't matter where we walk. We're just in nature. We're just here. It's not about the destination. It's about the journey. Absolutely. But it was so good. And I was seeing that mud, glorious mud. Nothing else, like a child.
And of course, with that as well, if you are going to be in sacred sites, that is also going to be amplifying any spiritual practice that you do. And you know that there are many incredible sites. So it reminds me, talking about mud, of being at Montségur in the south of France just a few weeks ago, doing the recce for our upcoming Mary Magdalene tour, Cape Dal tour that we're doing. And for some reason, I don't know why, every time when we were there last year in July, which really doesn't make any sense, and I suppose it's a little bit more expected at the end of March that it might be.
You've
that way.
You've been through this, honey. Your name is Lorraine.
I really changed my name to Lesun.
Lesun.
Le heat wave.
Yes. Wave.
You better not bloody bring it to Egypt, or it'll be in the doghouse.
Le hot. Yeah, but I don't think I've ever seen so much mud. Every time we go there, it just rains.
Oh God, it's like coming down in a mud waterfall.
So I'm going to set an intention. I'm going to be meditating and visualising, and I'm going to create a vision board that has Montségur this July with blazing sunshine, because I really do think it's time we need to bring some light to that area. But yeah, doing those exercises in sacred places, so Egypt, which again we're going to very soon. And sometimes you don't even have to do the spiritual practice. That's the thing that we fail, that we go there and it's like sleeper cells that are in you. Just wake up and you remember stuff, and add the spiritual practice to that high energy, and it's just amazing what comes in. People that have never channeled, or people that have never been able to hear their guides or see stuff, suddenly find that all of those senses, all of the clairaudient, clairvoyant, clairsentient, it's all just amplified.
Yeah, we had this in Glastonbury a couple of weeks ago. Yeah. And I'd been out in one of the other villages, which I grew up in that neck of the woods, so I'd been out there and the energy there was super heavy. I came back feeling really ugh from this village, and I was with a friend of mine, which said, we've got to go back to Glastonbury. We've been once already, but I'd undone it by going somewhere else. It's like, you know, I need to just go and top up one more time before I go back to London.
When you're driving in there, you're just...
Well, it's kind of more loud music for driving.
Mustang Sally on the road to Glastonbury.
I think we've only got time for one more from... it's Lady Tariska, which is her Instagram handle. She's fabulous. She absolutely loves her garden. This woman is, she's passionate about her garden, so thank you for this. She loves getting out in her garden amongst her flowers and her veggies, listening to the birds sing, grounding herself to the earth, sun on her face, thanking Mother Nature for all of her bounty that she provides for her to live on, and the joy that she gives in the beauty of her garden. Genuine passion for...
That's my hubby, I think. He wouldn't even think himself spiritual, but isn't it right in that gardening? It's totally passion.
And there's loads more, so thank you to everybody who replied to that and took part in the poll and gave us their version of spiritual practice. I'm sure we'll be running others in the future.
So if you're not on our Facebook or Instagram, please do join our community. We'd love to hear from you. We'd love to... we're going to be putting out more questions, there'll be competitions, there's all sorts of things. We're running workshops and retreats and
events, and you know, we're still I think we're still really early days. But already it's gaining that momentum, and the people that are sort of coming on board or being interviewed by us, it's just all falling into a really nice place. And yeah, just looking forward to seeing where it goes.
And just one final thing, another one of my favourite spiritual practices is meeting up with these two and filming these shows.
Absolutely.
Thank you for watching.